Here we go.
Does not necessarily represent the views or opinions of the staff, management, or ownership of this station. It's time to get on the right path with Right Path Real Estate Radio with Tom Perry. Get the answer to your question that's keeping you from taking action and succeeding today.
Welcome to the show.
Get ready. The guide that will put your fears behind you is on the air now. Taking calls at 713-785-1817. Toll free 877-881-0271. Now here's your host, Tom Perry.
Hey, good morning. Welcome to the show. Welcome to the show. Right Path Real Estate Radio. 713-785-1817 is the call-in number. My name is Tom Perry. I'm the host of the Right Path Real Estate Radio Show. It is Wednesday, hump day. I'm joined live in the studio, my good friend, my brother from another mother, my co-host, Mr. Daniel G.
Good morning, everybody.
How are you doing?
I'm amazing.
Yeah.
You know, it's so. I was telling my wife the other day that, you know, sometimes when nobody knows where you are or people are asking where you are,
yeah,
and they ask me, you know, the girls in the office will tease me,
yeah,
because I'll be like, I don't know, I haven't talked to him.
Yeah.
What? Brother from another mother? You don't know where he's at?
Oh, the funny.
So,
yeah,
right. Pretty hilarious.
I can picture Maribel saying that.
Yes, of course.
Yeah, right.
I say girls in the office so I don't have to call her out.
Yeah, but, right. You know. Yeah. That's all right. I'll call her out.
It's funny.
Yeah, she's hilarious. So, yeah, I mean, you typically know where I am. And
most of the time, yeah.
Most of the people in the office typically know where I am.
Well, if you just look at the calendar, it's not really hard to figure out.
Right. Yeah. I pretty much follow that.
He's on an appointment.
And if I'm not, you know, if I'm not on an appointment, then I'm typically either here or at my townhouse working on stuff. I mean, so, you know, I don't even know where to go and buy bonbons. So it's not like I'm sitting home and eating bonbons.
There's got
to
be a place.
Yeah, there's got to be the bonbon store. You know, if there can be a Bundt cake, like nothing but Bundt cake.
Yes.
I saw that. I was like, are you serious? I mean, somebody can make a living just making Bundt cakes.
Just making Bundt cakes.
Yeah. Wow. So so then surely maybe somebody can just make bonbons.
You know, there's got to be. I'm sure there's somewhere in this country, this great country of ours, there's a small business based on bonbons.
You would think.
Got to be.
So anyhow. Well, so the title of today's show is Knowing How is part of it. Execution is the rest of the story.
Yes.
And you know, one of the things I came in this morning, I was thinking about, you know, I talked to my mom every morning on the way in. It's a 7 or 8 or 10 minute, you know, drive, maybe 6 minutes coming in. And I'm not bragging, I'm just saying.
Just saying.
But I live pretty close to the office. Of course, we're not going to be in this office space for too much longer.
Yeah.
And we've got RFPs out right now for some new space. And
so, for those that don't know,
yeah,
myself included, because I repeated that to somebody the other day.
Yeah.
I said, we've got RFPs out. And they were like, well, what's that? I was like, I don't know.
An RFP?
Yeah. What is an
RFP? Request for proposal?
Request for proposal.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, so anybody that's ever done contracting or bid work or things like that, no, you know, typically corporations go out. You know, I remember when we used to be in my dad and I in the security guard business.
Yeah.
You know, people would go out for an RFP, and for, you know, so many hours of man hours of coverage. You know, whether it's Lyondell Petrochemical or an office building or a bank or things like that. They
makes sense.
Anytime the city government's going out or state or, you know, national government's going out for bids, then they put together, they'll typically have a pre-bid meeting to answer questions, things like that, and then they have an RFP that spells out the scope of work and all that kind of stuff. And
awesome.
And so in this case, we're asking the buildings to give us a proposal
and
to kind of put their best foot forward, saying, hey, we're comparing multiple buildings.
Hey, we're looking for highest and best.
That's exactly right.
Yeah, awesome.
And
well, now I know.
Yep. So that's what an RFP is.
Tell people, hey, you know, you don't have to know everything. You just have to know somebody that does.
Right.
And very often you could just repeat what they said.
Yeah.
So it works.
Well, with a lot of the different you know, things that I've sold in the past.
Yeah.
You know, calling on big industrial plants, or calling on, you know, city government, that kind of stuff. Then you deal with a lot of RFPs, and you know every industry has its acronyms,
of
right?
Course.
And then that's an acronym that goes across, you know, industry lines.
Yeah.
And but anyhow, so I think everybody kind of falls in the trap of your language, right? In fact, one of the things that you remember when we first started teaching, we recognize that, you know, you can tell people that have been in this business for a while and all that kind of stuff based on, you know, what their language is.
Yeah.
You know, you sit down with a neurosurgeon for very long and you realize, oh, well, he's speaking a totally different...
Yeah, especially if you're talking about neurosurgery, right?
Right. He's speaking a different language.
And it's the same thing if you're sitting down with, you know, an oil and gas guy.
Yep.
Or, you know, you could take an upstream guy with a downstream guy, put them in, they're not even going to communicate the same, right? Same business.
They have a lot of commonality.
Some,
because,
yeah.
Yeah, because oftentimes, you know, there's a... flow, no pun intended, back and forth. Some upstream guys stay upstream all the time.
Yeah.
So anyhow, but there's relationships there and all that kind of stuff. And so if you're a good upstream guy, you have to know how you're
going on downstream.
Yeah.
For sure.
What impact you're having on what they're doing and all that kind
so
of stuff.
So I really like today's topic, and it's funny because you and I didn't communicate. Mm-hmm.
Did you watch the Astros last night?
I did.
Yeah.
This
and
morning,
they obviously know how.
Of course.
But execution is
It's important. Well, and a lot of it, it's not even the execution, the correct execution.
Right. Mm-hmm.
In this business, what I see most of the time is it's the attempted execution.
Correct. Mm-hmm.
So my morning post this morning was a true decision. Mm-hmm. Is followed by some sort of action.
Right. Mm-hmm.
If there's no action, you didn't truly decide.
Correct. Right.
Right? Mm-hmm. So it kind of falls into you know, it's not just knowing.
Right.
It's not just deciding.
Right.
It's taking the action.
Correct.
And most people have trouble with that part.
Oh my gosh.
And a lot of times you see folks that because they're having trouble with the action part,
sure,
they go back to the more knowing part.
Right.
Well, let's go learn some more.
Well, that's something that feels like productivity.
Yeah.
That's not actually productivity. I mean, in fact, you and I were talking about a group of folks that we know really well that seems to be where they spend a significant portion of their time.
Yeah.
Is, you know, going to different, you know, places around the country to learn more.
Yes.
And the trouble is that there are so many people out there that are teaching that aren't actually doing what they're teaching, or they've done it on such a small scale. And I recognize that innovation is important, you know?
It is.
Yeah.
It is. But here's another problem I see with all those new innovations that are coming out, mm-hmm, right? It's if you are going to every one of these guys and then you're coming back to try to re-implement,
right,
especially when you have a team,
yeah,
that's one, it's going to, you know, cause attrition in the team. You're going to have a high turnover rate.
Correct.
Because people at the bottom of that food chain,
right,
will get real frustrated real quick by the constant change and never feeling like you're getting anywhere.
Right.
And then 3 years go by and you look back and you're like, you know, I don't feel like we're much further than when we started. Well,
right,
it's because you've started over six times.
Yeah, you're starting to stop.
When
and
you
starting
change
stopping,
your
right,
process and your systems in
right,
your business,
right,
or
right,
even if it's goals.
Right.
If you set goals for the next 3 to 5 years, mm-hmm, and then you readjust those every 3 to 6 months,
right,
you're gonna have a hard time reaching those goals.
Correct.
Because you're resetting them over and over and over again, and you're never giving enough time to accomplish those goals.
Correct.
So how do you truly know if a system worked or if the new one is even better if you've never given it the time to come to fruition?
Yeah, because it's a cycle, right?
I mean, it is.
It's definitely a process because, you know, we measure, you know, like our metrics, for example, we track them over a 90-day period of time because, you know, 30 or 60 days is really too short.
Yeah.
We log them on a weekly basis. In fact, that was something we had a meeting with some of our students yesterday.
I'm sure they're listening. You know, shout out to those guys.
Right,
so impressed by not just the delivery of their own information,
yeah, right,
but how far they've come
in
the 6 months or so since they've got started.
Right.
And looking back on that meeting afterwards, I don't even think they realize how well they've positioned themselves.
They don't.
For the next 3 to 5 years.
Correct.
And you could tell from them, they're like, not sure if this, you know, but man, talk about killing it.
Yeah, absolutely.
They are absolutely killing it.
They're doing
it
way better than what they realize they're
yes,
doing. Because in the moment, you know, oftentimes we measure things based on, you know, there's in business, there's cash flow and there's profit.
Yeah.
And with single family buy and hold, you know, there is some cash flow. And it's not bad. I mean, honestly, from a rate of return on your investment, I mean, it's somewhere between 8% and about 12% on single family buy and hold. Can it be better than that? Yes, it can be. But that's, you know, again, a batter can go 5 for 5.
Yeah.
You know, in a game, right? But or 4-4-4 or something like that. But no one's going to have a career like that.
Of course not.
And so by the same token, you know, you can do better on an individual property than, you know, than 12%. But as a, you know, as an across the board, you're going to average, you know, about 10%
on
the Houston marketplace. Now, it's less than that on a cash-on-cash basis if you're looking at, let's say, the California marketplace.
Yeah.
Most of the time, those are negative cash flow numbers. It's actually costing you more on a monthly basis to have the property than what you're bringing in rent. Between your taxes, your insurance, you know, your financing costs. And that's typically even on an interest-only situation.
Yeah.
So there, and that's where you can get creative on financing and that kind of stuff.
So that brings up another good point to me, and we can talk more about it. I know we're coming up on a break, but I'll bring it up and we can discuss it afterwards. I think a lot of times the knowing can cause people not to execute as well.
Right.
Because when we talk about a 10 or 12% cash on cash,
yep,
that's what we shoot for, and that's great.
Right.
But because people know that,
right,
what if a deal comes along that's 8% cash,
yeah, right,
on cash?
Right.
But it's still leverage appreciation is going to be 35% a year.
Yeah.
And people will pass on that deal because they know that they can get 10%
right
on another deal next month or
right
the month after.
Right.
How many deals are we passing up because the knowing is getting in the way of
the
execution?
Well, and what we don't know is how long we're going to continue to be able to get 10% cash on cash. What happens when, as the marketplace gets more competitive, and it will, right?
Of course.
That 10%, because it's already happening in California,
yes,
and where as the cost of properties rises, but the rent doesn't rise correspondingly, then those numbers shrink.
Yeah, at some point, the 8% cash on cash is going to be what everybody's looking for.
That will
right
be the median, right?
Absolutely.
Right. So, okay, you're listening to Right Path Real Estate Radio. Music says we're out of time. We'll be back in 3 or 4 minutes. Stay with us.
Hey, good morning, Nikki. Good morning, Jason. Good morning, Andy. Good morning, Aaron.
Hey, good morning, Aaron.
Good morning, Elizabeth.
And
good morning, Ashley. Good morning,
so Aaron,
Sabrina.
Are we on for tonight?
Oh, today's Wednesday.
Yeah. It is Wednesday.
Hump day.
Right. I'm going to go.
Hello, real estate investors. Do you need a lender that moves fast at the speed of a jet to fund your investment properties? Jet Lending will help you purchase properties quickly with as little cash out of pocket as possible. Jet Lending also sets up a repair escrow fund to help you with repair costs. Jet Lending has originated over 2,000 loans in Texas valued at over $250 million. Jet Lending will help you evaluate your deals for free and give you feedback on value, cost of repairs, and potential loan amount. Jet Lending is your fast and friendly hard money source for first-time investors and seasoned professionals. Call 281-872-7800 or email us at info@jetlending.com. Oh, and don't forget about our famous Third Wednesday Super Investor Networking Meeting. Lots of fun, lots of great real estate talk. We'll see you
there.
What's
going on, Don?
Time is money in a real estate deal. If your insurance company is slow or non-responsive, you could lose a deal like that. You need a quick turnaround on quotes, binders, and the agency for that is Benchmark Insurance Group of Texas. The team at Benchmark understands the investor mindset. They know what you need and when you need it. It's there for you. Call Houston's leading real estate risk management experts, Benchmark Insurance Group of Texas, 281-569-4353. That's 281-569-4353. Or online at benchmarkbroker.com.
Are you looking for an investor-friendly general
One
contractor
minute
for your investment property? Then call Fast Track Remodeling at 832-742-9992 or reach us on the web at fasttrackremodeling.com.
Fast Track Remodeling specializes in turnkey remodeling of single-family investment properties. Whether it's a flip rehab or a rental rehab, we manage every aspect of a rehab from start to finish with a highly efficient, standardized process.
Over the last 6 years, Fast Track has completed over 700 projects, which has helped us to create our three keys to success. Use a detailed scope of work so that everything gets done, train and maintain quality crews so it gets done right, and complete the work in a proper order so it gets done fast.
Sure.
No more managing it yourself, no more doing the work yourself. Fast Track Remodeling really does manage it all.
So give us a call today at 832-742-9992. Again, that's 832-742-9992, or reach us on the web at fasttrackremodeling.com.
This is Business 1110.
Mike's on.
Welcome back. Welcome back. Tom Perry, Daniel Gollinger, Right Path Real Estate Radio. 713-785-1817. If you'd like to call in and talk about anything real estate related.
I meant to get a water, but I didn't do it.
I could have grabbed you one. I'm sorry. Right. I grabbed one for myself and that one for you.
All right.
So before the break, we were talking about knowing getting in the way of execution.
Yes.
And was having a conversation at last base camp with, you know, there were, you know, some several-year students and then some several-month students.
Sure.
Right? And the several-month students are pulling the trigger on deals.
Right.
Because from the minute they began the knowing part.
Sure, right. What we were teaching 90 days ago is still the market today.
Yes.
And then there's people that bought a ton of properties based on what the market was 5 years ago.
Yes.
And then 4 years ago. And then they look at the market today, like a lot of people, they're looking backwards and going, oh, well, I'm still looking for a deal that looks like that. You know, let's call it a duck, right? Ducks looked like this 4 or 5 years ago, and now ducks have mutated, you know? And it's like, well, God, the duck today looks completely different, right? And, you know, I saw that when I first got started in this business back around 2010. I wasn't even on the investor side of things. I was on the general contractor with Fast Track.
Yeah.
But I remember walking properties, and I was a vendor of another real estate education company in the time that doesn't matter who and all that. But I'm not trying to hide it. I'll just say they're a good organization, just in my opinion, not great.
Yeah.
So what a deal looked like then was you could get about $300 a month positive cash flow. You could get about $20,000 of captured equity, and you could be about $5,000 out of pocket on a deal. And those deals existed by a lot. So somebody would come and join that group and have like $100,000 and like, oh man, I'm going to get, you know, 10 for my wife and 10 for me. And, you know, we'll have 20 rental properties, be out of pocket $5,000 per property. Well, then what happened is that the retail marketplace dried up.
Yeah.
In other words, there weren't retail buyers. You know, as investors, if we're buying at a discount, we're buying at a discount to the retail marketplace.
Yes.
And when retail buyers quit buying the fully rehabbed retail ready houses, you know, if you're an investor, I'm an investor, you buy a house for 130, then I see that as a comp and I go, well, I don't want to pay retail. But then, and the only reason why is because I'm not paying cash. I'm financing. And so, you know, most banks, because it's not your primary residence, you know, I got to put 20% down on 130, which gives me 26. So it's not five. So that 100,000 only gives me four houses.
Yeah.
So for a lot of people, it's a resources issue. And it's like, then they look at, well, if I'm only making $300 a house, I mean, I've got $100,000 and I can't, you know, that only gets me like $1,200 a month and I can't retire on that.
Yeah.
And it's like, no, duh, you can't retire on $100,000 anyway, right?
Yeah, you could. Yeah.
Right.
Like, but sorry, 12% is not going to get you there because you only have $100,000.
Yeah, you know, you have $5 million.
Yeah, 12% is more than enough.
12% on $5 million is a really, really good, you know, monthly income, right? So, or even, you know, $2 or $3 million. I mean, that's $3 million at 10% gets you $300,000 a year.
Yep.
For a lot of people, that's a lot. So the problem is, but that's not $300,000 leverage. I mean, that's $300,000 buying that's $3 million buying $15 million worth of properties in order to be able to get that kind of cash-on-cash return. Because the cash-on-cash return really drops. If you pay cash for the houses, for many people, I haven't done the math on this, that your cash-on-cash typically drops from about 10 or 12% down to about 8% when you're looking at just paying cash for a property.
I think a lot of people have a hard time wrapping their head around that because the cash flow amount goes up, but the percentage goes down.
Correct.
Yes. So I'm going to say that one more time. The cash flow amount goes up, but the percentage goes down. You should be basing these numbers based on percentages,
right?
Not just on, you know, and it's like,
well, if you make $300 a month, which is $3,600 a year, on $30,000 out of pocket, even though you're buying a $150,000 house, you're making $300 a month on out of $1,500 of rent on a monthly basis.
Yes.
Assuming you stay leased and all that, you know, you're going to have, after PITI and miscellaneous expenses and management fee, you're going to make about $300 a month on a $1,500 a month rent, and you could be $30,000 out of pocket on that deal. But if you paid cash on that, now you no longer have $30,000 in the deal. Now you have $150,000 in the deal, but you're not keeping all of the $1,500 a month because all you're losing, you're not losing taxes, you're not losing insurance, you're not losing the miscellaneous expenses, you're not losing the management fee. The only thing you're losing is the principal and the interest.
Yes.
and the principal actually is helping you, and the interest is, we're at such record low interest rates right now, it doesn't move the needle enough. So let's say that you know, if you made $1,100 instead of $300, yeah, you've gone up by, but if you take $1,100 times 12, just doing that quick in my head, is about 13.2.
Yep.
Okay, so 13.2 divided by 150,000 is about 8%-ish, not maybe 9%.
Yeah.
Just again doing it in my head. Well, that's less than making $300 a month on $30,000.
Yeah, so it's like if you said to somebody, "Hey, would you be interested in a property that the cash flow was only $225 a month?"
Yeah.
No, I wouldn't be interested in that. Well, hey, the out of pocket's only $8,000.
Yeah.
Like, now are you interested?
Right.
That's really good cash on cash, right?
Well, what you're looking at, there's really four variables that we can look at. What's the net cash flow that we're getting?
Yes.
What's the out of pocket that it's going to be? What's the equity at the time of purchase?
Yeah.
And then the fourth one is, what's the appreciation likely to be in that marketplace?
Yes.
Because let's face it, it's going to be different over off of, you know, south of Loop 610 off of MLK versus like Bear Creek, for example.
Yeah.
So if you take those four variables and recognize that those are like, you know, if for people that understand like how an engine works, you know, then, you know, as you increase fuel, then the car can go faster, but not if you don't also increase oxygen, right?
Because,
you know, what takes an engine to work efficiently is you need air, you need fuel, and you need spark. You need a heat source, right? You remove any one of those or you change. I mean, for people that understand, you know, engine things like that, you can run too rich on, you know, and you're not getting very much fuel efficiency.
Yeah.
You're not burning all the gasoline.
Well, I think another good analogy there, using that same analogy, is if the faster you're going, the less, the worse your gas mileage can get, right?
Correct.
Once
Absolutely.
You get past a certain point.
Yes. Yeah.
So it's the same thing in real estate.
Yep.
The faster you need to deploy,
right,
you may need to be a little less efficient on the return.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So,
yeah. In fact, that's one of the issues. I mean, in the beginning, in fact, probably for the first year or two, we had five or six meetings, Jason and I, with big money guys. I mean, guys that their business was raising, it was easier for them to raise $500 million than it was to raise $500,000.
Yeah.
And oftentimes that's the case. And so they were like, "Well, how quickly can you deploy $500 million?" And we're like, "Really, not that fast."
Yeah.
I could probably deploy $1 million this month.
Yes.
So give me another 500 months.
Know,
divide that by 12. Yeah, we could scale up. You know, next
if
month
we maybe scale up, we could get it done in 10 years.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, right. I mean, really, it for sure could take 5 years to scale up. And they're like, "Well, you don't understand. We owe interest on that."
Yeah.
Yeah, but the interest is only 1%. Well, yeah, still, that's
1% on $500 million.
That's $5 million, right? It's 400, you know, first monthly payment's $400,000,
yeah,
right? Who's stroking the choke for 400?
You got to be ready.
Yeah.
And you can't take it from the other money.
You can't take it out of the $500 million,
other,
right? Yeah, that's, yeah. That's called a Ponzi scheme.
Yeah.
You can't do that, right? So anyhow, so all that's to say, when you're looking at those four gauges on the dial, the one that gets me the most excited is the leverage appreciation side. And the one that I worry about, there's two that I worry about the least, really. One is it's the how much captured equity. That, you know, that used to be a big deal to me. And what I realize is the more I get involved in this, the less and less that really matters. Is because if imagine that you overpaid for a house in Spring Valley, you know, 20 years ago.
Yeah.
So what?
Yeah.
I mean, let's say you overpaid by 10%. I mean, that's a rounding error compared to what the value of those houses
exactly.
are today. Or imagine Bel Air or West U or, you know, some of these areas, when I look at, you know, what, you know, the neighborhood over where I grew up in Memorial, you know, just west of Gessner, but east of Benignus and between Memorial and like Memorial City Mall.
Yeah.
And, you know, to buy a house over there, like a 5-bedroom, 2.5-bath house over there for under $80,000.
Yeah.
And now, yeah, granted, we're talking about, you know, like 1975 or 76, something like that. But, you know, just lot value over there is like 550.
Yeah.
And so imagine if, oh, instead of paying 80, they had paid 90.
Yeah. Ooh, would that matter,
you know, 12%
today?
12% more. No, of course not. Right.
Yeah. And it's, you know, we were talking about baseball. It's like, sometimes you just need to get on base enough times to win the game.
Yes.
If you're trying to get to third.
Yeah.
if you don't win the game,
right.
like you can get to third and still never make it home.
Right.
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 So it's not always about, hey, what am I accomplishing up front day one in the deal?
Yeah.
It, real estate, I don't want to call it a long game because you can really, I mean, make really huge strides in short amounts of time.
Short amount, relatively, like it's 3 to 5 years.
Yes, but that's a short amount of time.
And 5 years is incredibly
short.
It's
a short amount of time.
You could be a multi-millionaire if you got started right now within 5 years.
Yes.
I mean, which is now with the right plan, with the right execution, and that's what we want to teach you how to do is,
yeah.
is how do you start with where you are right now and utilize, you know, your resourcefulness. In fact, you know, your resourcefulness, most people look at, well, I don't have enough resources to do that. And they go through this completely circuitous route in order to try and get to where they think they want to go.
Yeah.
And you know, I've been watching this documentary on Bill Gates recently, and he's working on some really world class problems.
I mean,
you know, trying to eradicate polio, and I was watching another one of the, it's a 3-part series, and I'm 7 minutes from finishing the third part, and he's looking at nuclear energy.
Wow.
and he said, you know, what's interesting is that most, and when you say nuclear energy, and most people have this real negative connotation
of
and think of the bomb and how dangerous it is and all that. And he said, you know, there's really never been
Two
an
minutes.
Approach to designing a modern nuclear energy plant.
Yeah.
And he said, you know, all the plants that are in existence today are really using engineering that took, most of them that exist today were engineered in the 40s.
Yeah, 40s and 50s for
right.
sure.
Right, but even the newest ones were engineered in the 60s and manufactured with 1970s technology.
Yeah.
And then so he's like, well, what if we could design with latest, and they've modeled it and all that, and it's incredible. And you think,
yeah.
why aren't people listening to this? Well, I mean, it's to get a message out to people that people want to hear. You know, people don't want to read books, and they don't. I mean,
yeah, of course, that's crazy.
Yeah, that's right. People want tweets. They get their message. Their people's attention spans are so short nowadays. So. All that's to say that if you want to learn how to build wealth and income, I haven't seen a better way to do that than single family. And I've looked at Airbnb, I've looked at multifamily, I've looked at commercial office buildings, I've looked at development, I've looked at retail, I've looked at, you know, all of those different things, and I comparing numbers for numbers. Now, the only exception is if you've got $7 million, $10 million, $15, $20 million and more to deploy. Yeah, some of those other strategies might be better.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, it might make sense to go park money just passively in multifamily on a
And for me, it's the no man's land between like 5 and 15.
Yeah, right.
It should be temporary,
right?
While you're deploying the rest, right, and then switching it up, right? Music says we're out of time. We're going to continue this conversation on the other side of the break. Stick around. We'll be right back.
Right.
Hey, good morning, Andrew. Good morning, Maribel. Good morning, Thomas.
Hello, real estate investors. Do you need a lender that moves fast at the speed of a jet to fund your investment properties? Jet Lending will help you purchase properties quickly with as little cash out of pocket as possible. Jet Lending also sets up a repair escrow fund to help you with repair costs. Jet Lending has originated over 2,000 loans in Texas valued at over $250 million. Jet Lending will help you evaluate your deals for free and give you feedback on value, cost of repairs, and potential loan amount. Jet Lending is your fast and friendly hard money source for first-time investors and seasoned professionals. Call 281-872-7800 or email us at info@jetlending.com. Oh, and don't forget about our famous Third Wednesday Super Investor Networking Meeting. Lots of fun, lots of great real estate talk.
I came in
we'll see you there.
A couple days ago. I meant to talk to you about it sooner. Not really sure how to go about responding to that other than that sounds
time
like a
is money
question.
In a real estate deal. If your insurance company is slow or non-responsive, you could lose a deal like that. You need a quick turnaround on quotes or binders? The agency for that is Benchmark Insurance Group of Texas. The team at Benchmark understands the investor mindset. They know what you need and when you need it. We're here for you. Are you a rehabber, wholesaler, buy and hold, or flipper? Bundling your properties on a single policy
about that
will
after
help
the show.
Save time and money. Benchmark has been in business for over 10 years, and we insure over 30,000 properties. Contact Benchmark about our exclusive investor package. call us and let us show you what we can do for you at 281-569-4353. That's 281-569-4353. Or online at benchmarkbroker.com. That's benchmarkbroker.com. That's 281-569-4353. Or online at benchmarkbroker.com.
Are you looking for an investor-friendly general contractor for your investment property? Then call Fast Track Remodeling at 832-742-9992 or reach us on the web at fasttrackremodeling.com.
Fast Track Remodeling specializes in turnkey remodeling of single-family investment properties. Whether it's a flip rehab or a rental rehab, we manage every aspect of a rehab from start to finish with a highly efficient, standardized process.
Over the last 6 years, Fast Track has completed over 700 projects, which has helped us to create our three keys to success. Use a detailed scope of work so that everything gets done, train and maintain quality crews so it gets done right, and complete the work in a proper order so it gets done fast.
No more managing it yourself. No more doing the work yourself. Fast Track Remodeling really does manage it all.
So give us a call today at 832-742-9992. Again, that's 832-742-9992. Or reach us on the web at fasttrackremodeling.com.
This is Business 1110.
Mic's on.
Hey, welcome back. Welcome back. Right Path Real Estate Radio, 713-785-1817. So we were talking about the four different gauges that you can look at when you're measuring a single family buy and hold. And so just to recap those, one is the cash flow. The second is the amount of money out of pocket, assuming that you're not paying cash that you're using, which most people, I mean, in order to maximize your rate of return, you should not be paying cash. Your rate of return paying cash for properties is about 7% on the appreciation side, about 8% on the cash flow. On your cash-on-cash return based on the amount of money that you have in the deal. As you apply leverage, if you're using 20% down, 80% finance, then your cash-on-cash typically goes from about 8% up to about 12%.
Yes.
Plus or minus a few percentage points, but about 12%. But your rate of return on the appreciation, on leverage appreciation, it goes from 7%. If your leverage 5-to-1, obviously goes to 35%.
Yeah.
If your leverage 4-to-1, you've got 25% down and you're financed the other 75%, then it's 28%. So you combine those two. If you're at 12% cash on cash and 35%, that's a 47% rate of return that drops to 15% rate of return. And again, I know radio's not great for numbers. But if you want to learn more about that, then all you need to do is tune in. I know we had one last night.
We did.
And
shoot an email. We'll get you a recording of it so you don't have to wait till next Tuesday.
Correct. But your rate of return based on your activity can reduce your rate of return from 47% down to about 15%.
Yeah.
And if you look, if anybody understands the rule of 72s and how quickly you can double your money doubles much, much faster at 47% rate of return versus 15% rate of return.
Yeah, absolutely.
And most people are like, they're happy with 15%. Like, man, I'm killing it at 15%. But now I'll also say this, depending on where you are in your life cycle, because like we borrow money, for example, at 6%.
Yeah.
Some at 5 and some at 6. And you people, might be thinking, well, why, if I could get 47%, why would, or even if I can get 15%, why would I ever want to do 6%? And it just really depends on where you are in your stage of life. If you're older and you want to, you want to set money and forget it. And it also depends on how much capital you're deploying.
It requires, different levels of involvement and work and risk. Right.
Imagine if savings and loan, or dating myself there. Imagine savings. If banks were paying, in mutual, in mutual accounts or money market accounts. Imagine if you could go to the bank and say, "Hey, here's $1 million. I want to park it here in the bank, and you could get 6%." I mean, a lot of investors would. I mean, let's face it. Investors will put $1 million in the bank at the interest rates that banks are paying right now. I mean, they don't put it in a single account. They spread it up.
To make sure it's insured.
Yeah. Exactly. They stay below the FDIC limits of insurance, but they'd rather have that safety and security. So imagine you could get 6% safe and secure backed by real estate. Some people say 6%. I'd be happy with 5%, right? Yeah. And so, in fact, I'm going to have a conversation with a really good friend, next week. that I talked to them yesterday, and they said, "Hey, I'd like my wife and I to go to lunch. Let's talk about that, because that sounds really. I mean, guy likes to play golf, and you know, just you know, let's you know, he'd rather do that than and just know that it's that. It, and every month he gets a check,
and I don't. He doesn't have to continue to work it every month.
No,
right?
He doesn't, so that's the at kicker. All. Right?
You know, and when you're talking about. You know, the type of money that we get and the rates that we get. And a lot of people are like, well, I could do so much better if I got there. You didn't start off getting those rates, right?
Oh, gosh, no.
And, you know, it makes me think of one of our students, you know.
I feel like you have to earn the right to get those rates.
Absolutely. Right. So, you know, a lot of times, you know, we were talking about when somebody comes in with $100,000,
right? Mm-hmm.
And it used to be that was 20 deals. Now it's, you know, 4 or 5 or 6 deals, whatever that looks
maybe
like.
Maybe 3.
Maybe 3 sometimes, right? So, what happens next? And we talk a lot here about resources and resourcefulness.
Right.
And I love seeing students that get started and they're starting off and they're doing this with their own money. When they first get started, they don't see what happens next.
Correct.
After they've deployed their capital.
Correct.
But then you fast forward 6 months.
Yep.
They own 4 or 5 houses.
Yep.
And they're buying more, but now they're using private money.
Sure, right.
But they would have never even had the skill set or the knowledge to get that private money in the beginning. They couldn't even see it.
Right.
Right?
No.
But now the whole new world has opened up to them.
Yeah.
And now they're getting private money. And then that private money is going to get cheaper the more deals they do and things like that.
Yeah.
And I love seeing that that evolution in our students.
Right.
And when I see people now that are at the beginning and they can't see it yet, it's like, I can see it for them.
Right, yeah.
And I'm like, you have no idea what's going to open up, right? You've got all kinds of things coming your way.
Yeah. That it's you almost just, like you want to say, come along, young grasshopper.
It's going to be fine. Yeah, it's going to be fine. And you just don't see it yet.
Right,
and once you get there, it all opens up and bigger and better things happen, right?
Oh, my gosh, yeah. Well, and then you realize that, you know what? This is the way a lot of business is done. Very few people start a business. I mean, I'll say this. There's too many people that start a business undercapitalized, and then that's the number one reason why businesses fail.
Yes.
You know, poor execution and lack of capitalization, right? And however, when I look at, you know, who are some of the businesses that we look to, like, wow, like the first $1 trillion business is Apple, you know, and I think, did Steve Jobs have the money that was necessary in order to start that company in his own resources, right?
Yeah.
No, but did he have a resourcefulness? Yeah, he had incredible resourcefulness. And then, you know, even you look at Mark Cuban or Zuckerberg or you know, Elon.
Even if they started with what they had, at some point, in order to scale,
you outgrow your resources.
Yeah, they brought in some other outside resources,
Bezos,
right?
I mean, there's no way that he could have done what he did without bringing in outside resources. He had incredible resourcefulness, and people talk a lot about, you know, how much Amazon lost in the beginning days, but that was because of expansion. They were winning on a transaction basis, but they were losing because they were reinvesting everything they made and more into a distribution network and warehouses and all that kind of stuff, and you look at where they are today and incredibly profitable, and it'd be interesting to see, you know, who 5 years from now is more has a larger market cap or more profitable. But then talk about market cap. You know, one of the things that I love about single family real estate as an investment versus, you know, having money in a 401k in the stock market, things like that, is when you're looking at what you're paying for assets. I mean, people think, oh my gosh, you know, I used to buy, you know, a piece of real estate in Bear Creek for, you know, $95,000.
Yeah.
Now it's, you know, almost $200,000.
Almost $200,000,
yeah. Right. And it's like, oh, that's so expensive. And I'm like, no, here's the issue. You can still make a 40% rate of return on that purchase.
Yeah.
But can you make a 40% rate of return on Apple today? I mean, you're buying that at like an 18 times what this year's profit is. It's like, so you're prepaying the next 18 years profit when you buy almost any stock that's in the marketplace right now.
Minimum.
So, you know, I've had an opportunity to have some conversations with people that are actually in the financial industry that help place people's money and, you know, go out there. And it's interesting because I find that people, the younger guys that are new in the financial, you know, investing world, they're still bright-eyed and kind of wowed by, you know, the big business. But then there's other guys that have been in it for 15, 20 years, and they're like, man, oh, man, there's no way I would tell my young, you know, kid.
Yeah, or you're like, hey, how much do you have invested? Yeah. Like, I don't know.
Yeah. People ask me, you know, hey, how much money do you have in the market versus how much do you have in real estate? And what I can tell you is I have zero in the market.
I find it so funny the reaction you get from people when you tell them that.
Yeah.
They're like, well, Yeah, but like none?
Yeah, like you're none. Like,
no, when I said I don't have any, that means zero.
Right.
And they just have a hard time comprehending that.
Yeah.
Right? And they're like,
yeah. Well, it's like, the valuation, you know, if you simplify things, you know, conceptually and I'm not saying people are not smart. I mean, everybody that I run into on a regular basis are really bright, smart yeah. people. But what happens is you put so much focus in one area that you're not, watching this Bill Gates thing. I mean, they ask him, what's his favorite food? And his favorite food's a hamburger. And I was thinking, oh my gosh, you put so much focus and energy into these certain things.
It's like, it's the people that are shocked by that people that can't wrap their mind around not being involved in the market, at least in some way.
Yeah.
It's because they've been taught wrong.
Right.
Right.
Of course.
And that doesn't make them less smart.
You're bought into marketing that you see.
Absolutely. Yeah, right. I mean, it's like our school system. You take history in an American school, and then you take history outside with the same events, they're not going to be the same.
Yeah, right.
Right? So what you've got to realize is the financial institutions, the food industries, things like that, a lot of that has been propaganda to get you to act and behave the way you're acting and behaving.
Right.
And
what do you think is being taught in Japanese, German, and U.S. schools about World War II? I mean, it might be a slightly different story.
Some different stories.
Different perspectives, absolutely. Right? And so, that my dad has joined us in on
good morning,
the
Mr.
Book
Perry.
Of Faces, and he's actually graduated a year ago in May with a master's degree in history.
2 years ago in May.
This past May was a year, I believe.
Yeah. So this coming May. Oh, yeah. I thought you were talking about May, not this coming May.
Well, because we're only we're in October now, so that's 5 months.
We were just talking about not looking back.
Trying to wrap around.
But
again.
we said we don't look backwards. So
I
just assumed
history,
you were going forward.
You have
forward.
To look backwards. History is about
history
looking
is
backwards.
About looking backwards.
Yeah. So anyhow, the conversation I'll probably have with him today, not right after the show, but I'd like to ask him if he knows, like, what do the Japanese and Germans teach about World War II versus what do the Americans teach about?
You sure it wasn't May of 17 that he graduated?
No, I'm pretty sure it's May of 18.
Well, he's here. He can tell us.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyhow. So, all right. So you're listening to Right Path Real Estate Radio, and really what we're talking about is I would love to have anybody that believes that there's something better, or they want to ask the question, hey, what about this? You know, and want to know, is there something better out there? And
give us a challenge. Say, hey, compare these two.
Yeah.
And we would love to hop on a webinar or something and make a quick argument about one versus the other.
Yeah, because you know what happens if you have 100,000? What happens if you have 1 million? What happens if you have 3 million and you were trying to deploy that? What gives you the because that's really what it comes down to is there's two variables that you're looking at is what's the rate of return that I can get it on my money, but then also what's the time investment that's required?
Yes.
And so the more passive that you get, the lower that rate of return is, right?
Correct.
Now, because and so the question becomes, you know, if you can get 6%, 100% passive, are you happy with that? Now, is 7% better? Yes. Is 8% better? Yes. But then you start, as it starts going up, how much risk is there?
Yeah.
So you're looking at risk
utilization rate and
right.
all that kind of stuff,
exactly
too.
Right. So I know Japan teaches it differently. They almost skip World War II completely. Yeah, that's convenient.
We don't want to talk about that.
Yeah. So anyhow. So of all the different things that you can invest in, and I won't name them all. You know, Bitcoin comes to mind, which I don't consider an investment at all.
It's not
because to me that's like buying dryer lint. You know, it's just like
it's going to go up in value. Yeah, I can feel it.
Right? Yeah.
Well, at least dryer lint you can hold in your hand.
I know. Right.
Right?
Bitcoin, not so much.
You can't.
Yeah. So. But I mean, yeah. Just talk about just assessing value to just some electrical digits, right?
Yeah.
And then saying that this is worth something because we can't make more of it. Yet they seem to. If you can't make more of it and it's completely traceable and all that, then how do the people keep stealing it?
Yeah.
So you're listening to Right Path Real Estate Radio. We'll be right back in a couple of minutes.
Time is money in a real estate deal. If your insurance company is slow or non-responsive, you could lose a deal like that. You need a quick turnaround on
you,
or binders.
Talk to the guy about the house down there yesterday.
Benchmark Insurance Group of Texas.
I did.
The team at Benchmark understands the investor mindset.
They
know what you need and when you need
it. He thinks it's worth more than it is?
Oh, yeah.
Are you a rehabber?
He says that he's been offered
buy and hold or flipper?
Like,
bundling
close
your properties
to 100.
On a single policy will help save time and money. Benchmark
and
has been
well,
in business for over 10 years,
that doesn't,
and we
doesn't
insure
work
with 30,000 properties. Contact Benchmark about our exclusive
investor
package.
About, you know,
call
you'll know it's a legitimate deal.
You,
I mean, ask for,
can do for you.
Ask for earnest money.
281-569-4353.
Ask for 5 grand.
Yeah.
See what they say.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. 281-569-4353. Or online at benchmarkbroker.com. That's benchmarkbroker.com. That's 281-569-4353. Or online at benchmarkbroker.com.
Hello, real estate investors. Do you need a lender that moves fast at the speed of a jet to fund your investment properties? Jet Lending will help you purchase properties quickly with as little cash out of pocket as possible. Jet Lending also sets up a repair escrow fund to help you with repair costs. Jet Lending has originated over 2,000 loans in Texas valued at over $250 million. Jet Lending will help you evaluate your deals for free.
Yeah, Thomas, I agree with that.
Feedback on value, cost of repairs, and potential loan amount. Jet Lending is your fast and friendly hard money source for first-time investors and seasoned professionals. Call 281-872-7800 or email us at info@jetlending.com. Oh, and don't forget about our famous Third Wednesday Super Investor Networking Meeting. Lots of fun, lots of great real estate talk. We'll see you there.
1 minute.
Are you looking for an investor-friendly general contractor for your
My brother
investment
said he went
property?
To this.
Then call
Fast
Track Remodeling at 832-742-9992 or reach us on the web at fasttrackremodeling.com.
Fast Track Remodeling specializes in turnkey remodeling of single-family investment properties. Whether it's a flip rehab or a rental rehab, we manage every aspect of a rehab from start to finish with a highly efficient, standardized process.
Over the last 6 years, Fast Track has completed over 700 projects, which has helped us to create our three keys to success. Use a detailed scope of work so that everything gets done, train and maintain quality crews so it gets done right, and complete the work in a proper order so it gets done fast.
No more managing it yourself, no more doing the work yourself. Fast Track Remodeling really does manage it all.
So give us a call today at 832-742-9992. Again, that's 832-742-9992 or reach us on the web at fasttrackremodeling.com.
This is Business 1110.
Mike's song.
I love it when we finish out with cowbell. All right. Welcome back. Right Path Real Estate Radio. So we've been talking about knowing how is just part of it. Execution is the rest of the story.
Yes.
And we can talk about the Astros. They obviously, all those guys, Gurriel, Altuve, Verlander, they all know how. But that's only part of it. They don't get out there and execute, then their season could end tomorrow night. God forbid, right?
Yeah.
But, you know, they got to execute. They got to out-execute the other team, that little team from Florida, the little train that could.
Yeah. And, you know, you and I were discussing, hey, I thought they would go with Verlander.
Yeah.
And, you know, you thought that was a bad move for the long run.
I did.
So,
yep.
Even in the short run,
yep.
You've been proved correct.
Yeah.
So,
right.
I'm assuming they're going with Cole tomorrow.
Yeah, but he's on regular rest.
Yeah.
Versus, I guess, Verlander was a day early.
Yeah,
right?
He was a day early.
Yeah. So, which it's only the second time he's pitched a day early, like, in his whole career.
So, I heard a stat. There's been, like, 120 times that's happened in the playoffs.
Yeah.
And the win-loss was not favorable.
Yeah.
In that situation.
Yeah.
I think it was almost 3-1.
Yeah.
That the pitcher going on short rest in the playoffs loses.
Yeah.
You know, 3 out of 4 times.
Wow. Well, yeah. So go Stros for tomorrow night.
Go Stros for tomorrow night.
But more importantly, here's the question: are you ready to take action?
Yeah.
Because if you now it's important how you answer that, because your answer really should be no. Because I know that when we took action for the very first time, we weren't ready.
Yeah.
In fact, that's the real head, you know, banger, if you will.
Hey, no, I'm not ready, but I'm going to.
That's exactly right. That's an aha moment for many people. If I had waited until I was ready to take action on many of the businesses that I started, I never would have started a business.
Yeah. It's kind of like, hey, are you ready to have kids? No.
You're never ready.
You're never ready.
You're never ready.
You just have to do it.
You got to pull the trigger.
Absolutely.
So, yeah. And so what you find is that, you know, here we are over 600 transactions later after of doing houses, that, you know, we're still learning.
Of course.
I mean, the market is still shifting. It's still transitioning. And so what I'd recommend is align with someone that's doing it regularly at a high level. You know, I know that what we're doing today is dramatically different than what we were doing back
Absolutely.
In 2013, because we're seeing shifts in the marketplace. How do we see those shifts? Because we're in the marketplace.
Yeah.
We know the Houston market, but we also have students that are in Dallas. We have students that are in Seattle. We have students that are in San Francisco and other places. So we know what's going on in those markets as well. Now, for many of them, our recommendation, you know, like in San Francisco, don't invest in San Francisco.
Of course.
Don't buy there. That's not a good place to buy. And if Houston was a market that was priced like that, we wouldn't be buying in Houston either.
We wouldn't. We'd be in Indianapolis or wherever the market was favorable.
Correct.
Right. Absolutely.
And as the market continues to shift, like right now, we're anti-multifamily.
Yes.
For now.
2 minutes.
Now, I'm not anti-multifamily as an investment. I'm anti-buying multifamily today at today's prices.
Yes.
What I'm not opposed to is as that market shifts in the future,
yeah.
and when there's a crash, man, I'll be in like a hawk.
Yeah, head first.
Absolutely, because you know I want to be that scavenger that's picking up the pieces.
Yeah. Now you won't be completely ready.
No, I won't.
When you do dive in,
no, I will not. But I will dive in.
But you will dive in.
I'll be more ready than most.
Of course.
Right.
Yeah.
But
you can never know it all.
You can never know it all. You got to actually do it. Now. Yeah, San Antonio too, Brad. San Antonio is a great market.
Yeah, I had somebody ask me at the Draco, the Wholesale Nation event the other night. Mm-hmm. Hey, you know, I've heard you on the radio and things like that. What would you tell somebody that was just getting started in this business?
Yeah.
And the answer to that is start sooner.
Yeah, right.
Don't stop. If you haven't done a deal,
yeah.
stop One waiting minute. To do a deal.
Right.
You're going to look back and when you do have a lot of this figured out,
yeah.
you're going to look back and go, I didn't need to know all this to get started.
Right, absolutely.
I just needed to get started.
Right.
Because then the knowing actually really starts to make sense and happen and things like that. So.
Right. All right. Yeah, you're listening to Right Path Real Estate Radio. And so, yeah, get started. I mean, that's, you know, the Nike slogan, just do it.
Just do it.
Right, yeah. And that I think that for 90% of the people,
seconds.
That's the biggest challenge.
Yeah,
is just deciding. You've got to decide that you're ready, even if you're not.
And making that decision, you have to follow it with actions.
Yes.
Otherwise, it's not a true decision.
Absolutely. All right, you've been listening to Right Path Real Estate Radio on Hump Day.
Hump Day.
I will be back in the studio tomorrow.
Build your team Thursday.
Yeah, build your team Thursday. Right. And so, thanks for listening, guys. We love you. We'll see you tomorrow.
All right, guys. Be good.
You've been listening to Right
Strokes.
Path Real Estate Radio. Find Tom at rightpathrealestate.com. You can put the fear behind you and listen every day from 9 to 10 a.m. on Business 1110 KTEK.